This is WCBG, broadcasting from Wagner College in Staten Island, New York. WCBG, small college, big boys. I'm Jeanine, and I had the chance to interview with Katie and Josh from the Mowglis in Asbury Park, New Jersey at the Stolen Pony. We interviewed them at the three-dimensional tour, which featured New Politics, the Mowglis, and the Plain White Tees. Stay tuned for this awesome interview. Thank you guys so much for doing this. I know I've been a fan since high school.
That's amazing. Nice.
Yes, waiting for the dawn.
That's so awesome. Thank you. Thanks for sticking with us.
Of course, I got super hyped to see that you guys were releasing like new music and going on tour, and cool. I was like, I had to reach out to see what was happening.
That's awesome.
Thank you. So I listened to your new song, Fighting for Yourself, and I really love the message behind it. And I feel like it kind of fits with, like, your brand in the sense that you guys are so positive. But at the same time, the music is, and the lyrics are super like relatable, and I thank you guys for that. So what was awesome. Like the writing process behind the song?
Well, Josh actually wrote the song quite a while ago. And we have a Dropbox that all the band members have access to, and whenever somebody writes a song, they put it in there, and then when it, you know, we find time and money to record songs, we kind of go through the Dropbox file and listen and kind of assess as a group what we want to put out. And for me, when I heard that song, I was like, okay, not only do I really, really want to put this out, but I really, really want to sing it. Like, I really, really relate to it. So, you know, I mean, he can tell you more about the writing process, but just the first listening process, I instantly felt like it was really relatable to me. As somebody who wasn't in the writing room at the time, I still felt really, really connected to it. But you have
I started co-writing with these two British friends, Lee Newell and Phil Bentley, and we've written like maybe 7 or 8 songs now together. And I just like, we work together so well. I just love those guys so much. And I woke up that morning and I had a session with them, and I read a horoscope, and the very last line was "Stop fighting with yourself." And so I was like, no. And it just kind of like, and the melody for that chorus line just kind of like hit me in the face. It was just like, stop fighting with yourself this time. And then Phil really helped me to shape the lyrics. I can kind of like give him an outline of what I want to say, you know, and he really helps me like put it all together and make it poetic and stuff. And then on the, as a band in our apartment, we wrote the bridge, and you know, I was just thinking about the song and what it is and what it means, and like those lyrics just sort of fell into place also, and so it was a really like seamless writing process almost, you know.
It's great when that happens.
Yeah, and then we got to record it with one of our oldest friends, Alex Arias, and we kept referencing My Chemical Romance. And then it turned out that the studio we used was this guy that had mixed The Black Parade.
Really?
And we were just like, what? And and so it all just fell into place, you know? And
I feel like those are always the best songs, you know, like when you're forcing it too hard during the process, it never really feels as easy to listen to. It's almost like that translates. So the ones that are really organic and just kind of happen always end up feeling the best for us, for sure.
You can definitely hear like the emotion behind the song in a sense. It's like this power anthem.
Awesome. Nice. It's really cool to hear that from a listener on the outside, that you hear it that way. I think power anthem is definitely a good way to put it. I know that we really put a lot of thought into what we want to sing to ourselves every night too, because there's a lot, you know, there's a lot of words that you could sing that could make you feel terrible if you had to sing them every night. But that's the message that I am happy to be reminding myself night after night, and hopefully reminding other people too.
Yeah. Definitely. I think it's something that is going to be one for a while, like one for the ages in a sense, just because of how it's just relatable and anyone can connect to that song.
It's felt really special playing it live from the very beginning of this tour. We released it and And like 3 days later, we had a college show in like Daytona or somewhere around there. and all the kids were singing it. And, wow. I was like, dude, it's been out 2 days, and these kids are all over it. And
I think some messages just are universal. Yeah. And I think that there's, if somebody out there is totally, like, the concept of fighting with yourself is totally foreign to them, they're an alien. You know, that's just, we all go through that. And so I think that's what makes, for me, that song so special is, I know everybody has been in that place. Everybody has been arguing with themselves internally and putting themselves down, and, you know, so, yeah, that's pretty much it.
So you guys have been releasing music for about 10 years, right?
Almost.
Yeah.
I think our first, you know, the band started at the end of 2009. We started playing some shows and making some demos. We put our first album out in 2012. So it's definitely been almost 10 years. Eight years.
Yeah.
And we've been touring since about 2012, 2013. So. Mm-hmm.
So can you describe your sound for me in three words, like how it's progressed?
I can't, honestly, no. I was going to try, but I just don't think we can. It's always evolving, and we try to be honest.
Right.
We try to stay on brand, but continue to change and grow. And
evolve with the times and the, you know.
But always just come back to that place, you know, and
yeah,
I don't know.
I often say, when I'm trying to simply put it to someone who doesn't know, I'm like, we play happy rock and roll music,
you know?
Because genres are all like blurry and you know, now, and so.
And I don't want to be defined by three words.
No way.
I want us to be able to, you know, if we want to write like a super electronic, like really progressive song, and that happens, and that's awesome. If we want to write like a super stripped down country song, I want that to be available to us. I just want us to be able to do whatever feels right in the moment and not be kind of cornered by any kind of definition, you know?
Yeah, we've always felt like that as far as like songwriting, especially. But I'm like super inspired by this band called Midnight right now, and they've got this real 80s synthy thing going on, and so like you might hear a song inspired by that soon, you know?
I mean, who knows?
I love that answer. I love how it's showing me evolution, that you guys are always trying to, you're staying true to yourself but also experimenting with different things, and I feel like that's so important.
It's a practice,
yeah.
You know, and I think it's like a practice with our music and our creative process, and a practice with ourselves too, you know? I want to always be able to evolve and grow and change with the times as a person and as an artist, but I always want to be able to stay true to, you know, who I am and what put us in this position to begin with.
I definitely feel like that's present in American Feelings, just because it's super, not just relatable, but also, like, relevant to the times, but also staying true to, like, that sound that you guys have, even, like, the production. Like, I don't know. I've been really interested in music production recently and just hearing how the track was made. You can hear, like, the time and the effort that went into, like, the chords and the harmonies. So I think that's super cool.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, the producer for that was Rob Elmore, and he did American Feelings and then the EP before that one, I Was Starting to Wonder.
Mm-hmm.
And he even did two of the tracks off of our third album, Where's Your Weekend Go? And he became just a really
cool,
good friend that Colin and I would write with. And then he, you know, it's just like we would start writing songs and that would just be the foundation of the production. So it made sense. And he's a really, really good producer.
Do you have a favorite lyric that you've written?
Wow. There's so many.
Yeah.
I feel like it's a hard question, but always interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I've always loved the line, "You only get what you put into this life."
I have a favorite lyric you've written. Love is easy.
Oh, yeah.
I still, like, always, like, I like that lyric a lot because it feels kind of... That's Tamar. He's great.
Tamar says hi.
Sorry to
interrupt.
You're fine.
No, you're not interrupting. You're featured.
Oh,
this
yeah.
is... You're now a feature of this
interview. Yeah, you'll be on college radio.
That's Tamar from Plain White Tees.
Hi.
He's awesome. Yeah, I don't know. I love is easy. That's a fun reminder, too, because it doesn't always feel easy, but at the end of the day, it's a choice, and that lyric is a reminder to me that it's a choice and that it's not something that just comes naturally, but making the choice to love can be easy.
So what do you guys do when you're not writing songs and not on tour?
We're obsessed with our dogs, like truly obsessed. I am not only obsessed with our dogs, but I'm obsessed with cooking food for our dogs. If I came into $10 million right now, I would probably invest in like a dog food company. I mean, I don't know. I'm assuming it costs $10 million.
Yeah, she's been cooking a lot of dog food.
And I'm really
more
into
dog food
it.
Than
and
human
I,
food.
Yeah.
Nothing against that.
No. It's an absolute fact. I read a lot about different dog diets and stuff. And our dogs are like my little dog food guinea pigs. And, you know, we've really...
And they're thriving, I will say. they're 10 and 12, and they're... They look like little puppies. They're great.
They're the best.
What kind of dogs are they?
We have a Portuguese water dog who's about 50 pounds, and she's 12 years old, and her name is Abby. She's an absolute angel. Mm-hmm. Just
and she's been to the Stone
being.
Pony before.
Yeah, oh, she wow. has. And then also, we have a tiny little mystery mutt, and her name is Suki, and she's 10, and she's my best friend, and they're just the best, and they're best friends with each other.
Oh, yeah. We catch them cuddling all the time when we come
home. They're amazing. But other than that, you know, we live in LA, and so we get a lot of outdoor activity. We love to hike. We love to ride our bikes around the city.
I play soccer as much as I possibly can.
We play soccer a lot. I dance a lot. We really try to stay physical and get as much vitamin D as we can before we hit the road.
Katie discovered this thing called Dance Church.
Okay.
And there's a couple of them around LA, and I think there's one.
They have a few in LA. There's one in Seattle. There's one in Salt Lake City. They're dance_church. On Instagram,
and she comes home just full of life after this like 2-hour dance session with a bunch of other people in a dance studio, and they just jam out to music and dance. And there's really like
therapy is so expensive, so I instead go to dance classes, and it's the best.
Yeah,
it's like that one outlet, the release you need.
It really is. It's like seriously the best, and I feel unbelievable every time I leave that class.
Amazing. So you guys have been on tour for a while now. It's been about...
We've been on tour, I think, like 5 or 6 weeks with, like, a little break at home at Thanksgiving, which was so nice.
Yeah.
And we're coming to the end of the road, and honestly, usually we're like, oh, my God, get me through this final week. I'm done. But we're sharing a bus with New Politics and, like, love them so much.
So much.
We're sharing a crew, and just everybody on our bus is, like, so sweet, and they're all, like, new friends. And to be totally honest, I'm actually, like, really sad to be leaving them. It's kind of sad. I, like, hate to think about it. But, yeah, we're coming to the end of this little time together, and it's been my favorite... They've been my favorite tour companions.
Yeah, they're lifelong friends.
Sure. They're just amazing.
I've already planned a trip to Nashville to write with Soren, and
they're the best.
So what was your favorite venue that you've played in during this tour?
I mean, we haven't played the Stone Pony yet, but it's definitely one of the most legendary venues,
yes,
not
is.
Just on this tour, but in like the country.
Mm-hmm.
So we're very excited about this show, and we have been
We
just have been.
We did
the
Fillmore
time.
In San Francisco, and that's just like a legendary spot.
Legendary.
They have, you know, so many weird rooms with like just covered in show posters
and
from
just
the 60s
like, walking
and 70s.
Around,
and
legends have walked past every step of that
just
venue.
Thinking about all those. Legends,
everybody,
like you just said,
everybody. I mean, No Doubt.
Who are on that stage? You know, it's a wild feeling.
Robin
like
Williams.
Standing there and thinking that, like Robin Williams was right
was
here.
Was right
you
here.
Jimi Hendrix was here.
Right
like,
here.
The Grateful Dead was here every
it's
Friday
amazing.
Night for like a while.
Yeah,
you guys played there. You're gonna be up
yeah,
there too.
Yeah,
it's the best. So that one really feels very like, cool. And I think that with the Fillmore and with the Stone Pony, like you really feel like you're like walking amongst legends.
Oh yeah.
The spirit, and I don't know. Maybe it's just like. Something in my head, but it's like you can almost feel like the energy and like the presence of all of the legends that have passed through. It's pretty powerful.
It's a nice dive into like musical history.
It really is. It really, really is.
Of the city, but
and it's like I mean, it's a dream since we were kids to be a part of that history and to like be amongst like to play the same stage as some of your heroes. it's pretty amazing.
It's always good. So both of you play multiple instruments?
No. This one is amazing. He plays everything. He is like the best guitar player I know, and for years he was in a band as their bass player, which is just insane. It's like, do you guys know how good he is at guitar? And you know, when we're like messing around at home, like he'll get on the drums and just like kill it, and then he's like, I can't play piano at all, and then he'll get on the piano and just like play something like based off of just like figuring it out for 30 seconds. So he'll tell you that that's not the case, but he's actually like pretty insane. And I just started playing guitar and am okay at drums.
Sometimes we jam and she plays drums.
Yeah.
And I
really
play
fun.
Guitar and we just play like 90s songs. It's really fun.
What made you guys interested in learning the instruments that you did?
I became interested in playing guitar because I was like, I want to play guitar on stage. Josh, teach me how to play these songs.
Yeah.
So I can actually only play the songs that I know how to play of the Mowglis.
Okay.
Like, I can't play any songs that aren't Mowgli's songs yet. But really, for me, it was a performance thing. I was like, I want to play guitar on stage and like be a full-blown rock star.
Yeah.
But this guy's got a longer history with it.
I honestly, I guess my mom and sister played piano and when I was a kid, and so I sort of like gravitated over towards guitar.
Okay.
Just to be different, maybe, and I had like a friend who played guitar and taught me a few chords, and I'm left-handed, but I learned on his right-handed guitar, so that it was like felt a little unnatural at first, but I did it and I got through it, and yeah, and now I really like sort of wish I knew how to play piano better, but you know, it's fine.
He's
I love guitar so much, and I'm like, you know, I grew up in the 90s kind of like grungy like thing into like Green Day and Weezer and that, you know?
Yeah.
So that's very just guitar heavy.
Yeah, it's very guitar oriented. It's kind of like what I've been listening to a lot lately.
Us too. I mean, we grew up
so
on that
cool.
stuff, and
yeah.
I it's always in the music listening bank. Like, you never, the songs you grew up listening to, like, they never, you can always go back to them in a way.
Right. I think that's fantastic. So, we have a question that we've been asking everyone we've interviewed.
Cool.
The question is by our PR director, Grace.
Mm-hmm.
She wants to know, what is your opinion of releasing an artist's unreleased music after they passed away?
Oh, this is a really interesting question. And I think
yeah.
it's really tough because I think it also just, it's so layered. I mean, it has a lot
mm-hmm.
to do with like, if that artist was signed to somebody,
mm-hmm.
then those people own all their whether they've released
yeah,
it or not.
Yeah.
And those
yeah.
people technically have a legal right to do whatever they want with it. And that artist will have signed that paperwork,
mm-hmm.
which is, you know,
yep.
saying we're cool with it. If it's an independent artist, it's a little, and then I think it becomes a lot more of a question of trespassing on their, it's basically like sharing somebody's diary.
Mm-hmm.
But if they've signed their work over, then it belongs to somebody else, whether they're alive or dead.
Yeah,
but I am not cool with what's happening, you know, with Taylor Swift and what's happened in the past with, like, the Beatles. Like,
mm-hmm.
I don't think it's cool when these, like, huge financial powerhouses get to outbid and outbuy an artist for the rights to their music before the artist is even aware that their songs became public domain.
Mm-hmm.
That's really not cool. I think that the artist should always get first. If
mm-hmm.
their songs become available for purchase, they should be the first ones to know. You know, there shouldn't be some like massive
mm-hmm.
dark money coming in and taking that from under them. That's kind of weird. But the postmortem thing is interesting, you know. I think that honestly that's a case-by-case situation. I think it's a little tough to throw a blanket over all every circumstance for that.
Yeah, I think my initial reaction to that question is the positive side of it is that you're sharing that more of that artist to
mm-hmm.
its fans. And for instance, when like in 97 or something, there was a Nirvana record released and there was like an unreleased song or two, and the same with the Beatles in those anthology records. They released that Free as a Bird track, which was awesome, And, you know, and as a fan, you're like, sick.
But also,
there's more that I didn't know about, you know?
And I bet both of those bands had signed their, like, they were signed.
Absolutely.
So,
and there were members of those bands who were alive, I suppose.
Right.
So it's, maybe that's different.
Right. That is different. Yeah, I think it's really
It's such a good question, though. It's, like, something people should be talking about.
I like to hear different people's opinions on this because I feel like it's so complex.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
yeah.
As a listener, you want to hear the music, but at the same time,
you
want to
respect
the artist.
Right. Mm-hmm. And that's why I really think, like, situations like this and so many other situations just cannot be, there can't be one answer for every situation. That's just insane, you know? Every situation in life is going to require a unique handling, I think.
Yeah.
And that leads me to my next question. What is one thing you would change about the music industry as it is today?
I mean, I don't know how to do this, but I would definitely make it so that artists just get paid more. Like, artists basically are these companies that are funding a lot of people and keeping a lot of people employed. And usually the artist, unless they have some unbelievable level of success, are financially struggling. I mean, so many bands we know have to tour full time, all the time, just to pay their rent. And somebody's making money off all those streams. Somebody's, you know, our booking agents probably make a ton of money.
that's my same answer.
But just at the same time,
make it more fair. And the writers.
Yeah.
As well.
Yeah,
because a song could get streamed like 10 million times and a writer still sees nothing.
Streaming
because they owe money to the publisher or something.
Streaming,
you know?
Is like pretty up. I mean, it's pretty crazy how many streams like we'll have, and we spend our lives touring our music so that people will listen to it, and we barely see any money off of those listens. Like, I would much prefer every single person who's a return listener on Spotify just Venmo us a buck. We would have over $1 million, you know,
per month.
And, you know, it's like, it's just crazy that I can't even tell you how much less than that we actually
see.
That's
a wild idea, Katie.
I feel like it's like one of the qualms I have with like Spotify and other streaming services, because I've interviewed a bunch of like local artists, and the pay is just not there. And even
I mean, it's great in some ways.
For exposure, it's perfect.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I kind of miss, like, going to, like, a record store and getting an album.
Well, also, like, you know, people are making money off of Spotify streams. Mm-hmm. It's just not us.
It's the labels, typically.
And that's the whole issue. It's like, it's not like there's no money being made. It's just that the money is not going to us. And, I mean, you know, I think that's probably one of the bigger issues in the music industry today. It's like you hear a lot of stories of artists that you think are so big and so successful, and they die penniless. We don't have health insurance. Like, that's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And that's real, though, you know? And we're not the only musicians. Like, you know, people will look at us and look at our numbers and be like, wow, they're really, like, pretty successful. But we work really hard to pay rent and to, like, make life happen for ourselves.
Yeah, that daily
and unless
grind.
We have some massive, huge, like massive, huge song, like we're working class musicians. And we're living the dream. Like, I love our job. I don't want to do anything else, but I could make a lot more money and have a lot more security doing something else. And that's just a sacrifice I make to have a job that I love.
You can definitely tell, like, you guys do love what you're doing, especially when we saw you guys doing sound check. Like, honestly, that was my first time seeing a sound check, besides for, like, our college concert. Does not compare at all.
That's awesome.
So, like, it was amazing for me to, like, see that and realize and be like, wow, this is fantastic.
Oh, cool. Thanks.
Well, we have, you know, our sixth member really is Jackson, our sound guy, our front of house. And he, you know, he helps to make things like that go smoothly, and because our team's just kind of dialed at this point.
Yeah,
it's a good team.
Okay, so my last question for you guys, because I feel like you're going to go soon, and I don't want to keep you guys any longer. What can we expect from you in 2020 and the new decade?
Oh my God, so much more music. We actually have been talking a lot about trying to, like, we have a new song coming out in January with a video. And we're also going to try to record two more songs in January before we go on our first UK tour ever. Ooh. My mom is going to see the Mowglis play for her first time ever.
Yes.
Because she lives, oh, my whole family is, but I mean, my mom's really the most important one. My dad, my brothers, my nieces and nephews, my cousins, mm-hmm. everybody in my bloodline lives in the UK, and none of them have ever seen our band play because we've never left this continent. So I'm so excited. And we're really just going to try to keep recording songs and making videos for these songs, because we've been making videos ourselves with a few friends back at home, and it's been so much fun.
Yeah.
And such a different a different way to tell the stories that are behind the songs, and it's been a lot of fun to do that. So we made that video for Fighting With Yourself with a bunch of our fans. Mm-hmm. It was so much fun. A few of our friends actually worked with us through email and phone and texts while we were on this tour and made a short film. They shot it literally like a couple of days ago for our next single.
Yep.
And we were able to do that from the road because we're not in the video. So we were able to just kind of like create the concept and kind of do it via email, phone, texts, FaceTime, all that stuff. And we have a concept for our next single. We're going to try to shoot that in February. And we're just going to try to keep creating in every way we can. We do a lot of fun creative stuff at home. Josh writes with a bunch of different people. We're making videos. Andy and I have been taking classes at Upright Citizens Brigade, which is like a really awesome like comedy school out there. We're just trying to do as much as we can to feed our creative selves. And it's, I think, gonna really bring a lot of fun stuff in 2020.
Yeah.
Well, thank you guys again for
taking the time to talk to us. We appreciate it. Thanks for sticking with us all these years and being on our journey with us.